we're going to talk about kind of the high points of my latest book, which is The Probiotic Cure, and I see they have a very nice supply of them over there. The previous one was on heartburn, because that is still a giant problem, and you can tell because you turn on the TV and there's an ad for, oh, take this drug and so you don't have stomach acid anymore and everything will be fine. That's a whole nother lecture, but that makes me crazy. So what I'm going to do is first give you an idea just how important our gut bacteria are. Secondly, how to take care of them. And then we'll also talk about some of the kind of marketing myths around probiotic supplements, because it seems like overnight there are, I just in March went to a trade show, biggest trade show in the nutrition industry out in California, and I swear there must have been 1,000 products there that were probiotics. Mm-hmm. There will very soon be probiotics sprinkled on your Doritos, because it's a magic marketing word. Even though people don't really understand what they do, what it's all about, they just know it's a good thing, kind of like kale and gluten free. Let's add that. And when you get it in something like kombucha, that's good. Sprinkling a little bit just to say you did on something that's bad for you to begin with, not so much. So we'll get into that. We are now coming to grips with something. Those of you who don't know who Hippocrates was, he was an ancient Greek, credited with being the father of medicine. So we're talking at least probably a couple thousand years ago, and he knew it, that our health and all disease begins in the gut. So it's taken us 2,000 years to reinvent that idea, because now we know why. And that's the whole thing with science. They have to, I should have turned on this timer. It'd be really nice if I remembered how to do it. Oh well, somebody will wave at me when I've talked too long. With science, they aren't so much concerned with what happens as why it happens. So that's why testimonials, one reason, I mean, there's no money in testimonials, where there is in getting grants and doing more and more studies, but one of the reasons that they don't pay attention to testimonials is they don't know why. Well, yeah, fine, if you eat a healthy diet, you don't get cancer, diabetes, and Alzheimer's, and so on, but we're not going to go out ahead of the research and tell anybody to do that, because we need to know why. And so it has been with the gut bacteria. They knew they were there, didn't pay much attention until they started getting DNA evidence. Kind of started with a human genome, that when they developed this method for very quickly determining the DNA, they carried that over and started doing it with bacteria. That's when they realized, oh my gosh, there's something big going on here that we've been ignoring. Maybe there's some grants for us to study that. And an explosion, a literal explosion of research. Well, the first thing they did was, I'm going to see if I can move a little bit and stay out of the way. The first thing they discovered is how many of them there are. We knew that there were somewhere around 3-4 pounds of them, but that was just bulk. Now we know on the cells, there's 10 times as many cells as what our body has in the gut. And they call the whole collection the microbiome, and it is basically an organ. It has as many jobs, it's as complicated as your liver, your kidneys, maybe more so really. But they kind of equate it to the liver, because, am I throwing off the taping back there. Maybe if I stand over here, it'll be better. It weighs about the same as the liver, and so far they've found that it has at least, if not more, functions than the liver. So now it's getting some respect. That is the one that really got my attention. 100 to 1,000 times more DNA collectively from our gut microbes than the ones that are in our cells. Wow, that explains a lot of things. Why we're different, because there aren't that many things in our cellular DNA to explain why we're so different, or why we're that different from monkeys and fruit flies, for that matter, because the DNA by itself is pretty similar. So now we know these bacteria with their 20,000 functions, and they make just untold, they're still counting, numbers of biochemicals that help run the body. They're actually a major part of our instruction manual and how we can run the body properly and not pay attention to their needs just doesn't make any sense. So this is an example. Some of our genes and our cells produce proteins. Some of those proteins are, as I note here, hormones or enzymes, that kind of thing, muscle tissue, cartilage, all kinds of proteins. Humans have 23,000 genes that code for making proteins. The bacteria, 4.5 million. So what they're doing, it's got to be pretty important, and it's high time we not only found out about that, but stopped killing them off willy-nilly as we've been doing. We've spent at least a couple hundred years trying to figure out how to kill bacteria. That was our sort of our main directive, was to go out there and find more ways to pasteurize and sanitize and nuke with radiation, anything we could to kill bacteria with little regard, as an example, antibiotics, with what happens after that. So, and these bacteria are found, I don't know if you can all see the bottom line, but what we previously thought were sterile zones, like the lungs and the womb, not so much. These bacteria are everywhere. And it's really quite fascinating that they can tell not only if a thumbprint on a glass table was mine versus Dr. Cassano's, they can also tell if it was from the thumb or the elbow or your cheek, because every part of the body has a unique assortment. So there's a whole subtext going on of forensic bacteriology where, because your unique assortment is like a fingerprint, it's different than anybody else's. Keep that in mind when we start talking about probiotic supplements. If everybody has a different one, are we going to end up with 360 million products at the grocery store so that we can all get our own? Probably not. Now, these are some of the things that will determine the difference between one person's reaction and another. It may all be the microbes, and they're starting to show this. For example, with twins, they've found that the same diet, one identical twin will be fat and the other one won't. With animals, they have swapped those gut contents between the two when they had a fat mouse and a skinny mouse. And lo and behold, the skinny mouse gets fat and the fat mouse gets skinny. So that's that instruction manual at work. We've heard about the glycemic index, and we know that starches and sugars are bad, but if you give two people a piece of white bread, they're going to have different reactions. They aren't going to go according to the chart. And part of that reason is apparently the difference in our gut microbes. And we need to start figuring that out because this, what we've been told, I mean, oh gosh, the experts, the government, they have good intentions, I'm sure, but they have lied to us over and over again about what we should eat. They told us that, oh, the food pyramid, we need to eat all of these grains and starches and so on. I was there in Washington when that happened, and I can verify what is now on the record. That was not science. That was lobbyists that wanted to sell more of the grain products. Well, they've also, all of them, and because it's very simple and it stands to reason, they thought, calories in, calories out. Okay, we're all fat because we sit too much, we don't exercise, and we eat too much. So just stop eating, start moving, and I'll tell you, there are a whole lot of obese people would say, wait a minute, been doing that, hasn't made the difference. And it's partly due to what we're doing to our gut bacteria, probably in a lot of cases because we've messed up our blood sugar by following the government's advice, and happily that tide is starting to turn. But if you'll notice with things like that, we're talking about, what, 40 years it takes before the good science reaches practical levels. The same is true with statin drugs. We're now being told, oh, it was a major oversight, we didn't put that in the drinking water. Everybody should have it. Doesn't save lives except in a very niche market, but that gets lost in the conversation. It will take more decades, and probably until the drug companies come up with something they like even better, until that goes away and then they start walking it back. But I always like to take all of these official pronouncements with more than a grain of salt, a little skepticism, put it in context. This is not part of my presentation, but I cannot resist. You have to look at history. You know, what was happening 300 years ago? You have to look around the world. Are there populations that don't take statin drugs and don't have a heart attack? What are they doing that's different? Well, you've heard of the NIH, that's National Institutes of Health. A bigger factor is the NIH that stands for not invented here. If it's from Africa or Iran or Greece or whatever, you know, we'll do some studies here when it suits us and then we'll pay attention to it. So what I try to do on the radio show and in the books is acknowledge the science, but look for patterns that are also consistent with the history of mankind and that are not contradicted by something going on in the rest of the world. I think the science is important. It gradually gets us where we need to be, but some of our ancestors did quite fine without all that, so I think we can't ignore that either. So, more things that are different, maybe because of our gut bacteria. Drug effects, they don't bother all people the same, and they can't show that it's necessarily genetics or gender. It may be related to the bacteria. And I went to a Harvard seminar a couple of years. I went to Harvard symposiums while I was writing the Probiotic Cure. And I thought this was really very interesting. If the mom is stressed during her pregnancy, male offspring are more likely to have emotional problems. And they could tie it to a change in the mom's gut bacteria. So we're all worried that moms get calcium, but are we paying any attention to their gut microbiome? No, we're doing a third of the deliveries by cesarean section, which are preceded by antibiotics and followed by antibiotics. And that tidbit was new. It wasn't even published research when I heard it. It will take a very long time to trickle its way up into practice. So. Kidney stones, there's so many things now that are linked to the bacteria and medical mysteries that will be answered. I'm going to kind of screech through this, but what I just want to leave the impression about is how many different areas of health are being researched for the connection between gut bacteria and prevention.
What is TMAO?
Oh, okay. I will get to that in just a second. That's a good thing, and I probably would have jumped past it. They haven't proven, and the word proof, very elusive in science. As soon as you say something is proven, then there will be a lot of critics that say, no, it's not, and you'll have trouble getting your next grant. So when you read a report in the paper about some new breakthrough study, somewhere in there, before it concludes, it will say, more research is needed, right? I've never seen one that didn't say that. They almost always say, we're not ready to make any recommendations. Don't start making sure that your vitamin D levels are okay, because we're going to do some more studies, whatever. So, and probably some of these are premature as far as a cure goes, but they know there's a connection. They know now that there's something different about the bacteria in the gut of people that have these various conditions. Now, TMAO, I'm not going to bother to give you the technical definition, plus I forgot. But it's what it is you might have read that, oh, if you eat meat, you will have more of these levels, higher levels in your blood, and that leads to heart attacks or cancer, some dire consequence. But it turns out they have a bias. They are just sure that cows are bad for you and that fish are good, but as it turns out, you have more if you eat fish, and it all depends on what your gut bacteria do with that food. Do they turn it into this TMAO or not? All of the cancers, and this was probably the thing that shocked me the most in when I decided to write this book. I don't know, it's just self-punishment, whatever it was. When I decided to write this book, I started looking at studies. And before I was done, I had looked at 1,000 of them, trying to find out, well, I mean, it's all over the place. What are the consistent messages? And as I was looking at these studies, I would say, well, wait, this isn't in the Journal of Gastroenterology, although once in a while it was. It might have been in a cardiac journal. It was in the psychiatric journals. It was in the kidney journals. Every discipline is studying this now because they are aware of the gut-brain connection, the gut-kidney connection, the gut-lung connection. There were lots of studies in just this. You know, if there's a toenail journal or whatever, they're all looking at this. And certainly with relationship to cholesterol, and I think there's some pretty clear indications now, if you change your gut microbes, you can lower your cholesterol levels without those statins we were talking about. Diabetes, part of that related to what I said about how we react to food, but I think even more than that, because it affects type 1, if we're reducing autoimmune disease because we've got better bacteria, that's going to eliminate type 1 and some of the type 2, because later on it starts looking like type 1 because you've destroyed the pancreas. I highlighted breast cancer because I'm waiting for the October when I hear anything at all about your gut. You know, everything turns pink, but they don't even yet spend any of that massive amount of money that they raise to tell people, to tell women, and men too for that matter, check your vitamin D levels. So closely tied. And they don't mention that. Let me say, I think some of those are just fundraising machines for the sake of fundraising. But I really want to see them use more of that money for education, because that's the only true prevention. Mammogram, not so much. Mammogram is early detection. The process is already underway. More attention, please, on staying healthy enough that there's nothing to detect. Don't get me started. fatigue, that one ought to come pretty naturally, because if you have ever been constipated, you know if something's going south, well, no, it would be going north in your gut, you don't have any energy. Have you ever watched a dog taking a walk, does a big pile, and now he's full of energy, he's running around, he's all happy. Well, I think we're a little bit like that too, and it has to do with what's the top. If you have the wrong things going on, you're making toxins, you're breaking things down incorrectly and creating poisons that get into the system and so on. So everything from fatigue, and it isn't just the constipation factor. And I think if there's one misconception that's most widespread about probiotics is that their main function is just to keep us regular, because that's about all that Activia and most of these products can talk about legally, because as you may know, nothing natural can claim to prevent or cure a disease. And it does not matter how many decades, how many thousands of articles, it's the law. Only drugs can prevent or treat a disease. Nonsense. However, that's the way it is. So the public gets most of their education by commercials and reading what's on the product. So if the products only say helps keep you regular, in the case of Activia, eat it twice a day, it'll help keep regular if you can afford the calories. But also the bacteria, as we'll see a little later, they help you digest your food to extract the energy out of it. They help you pull out the vitamins. They create vitamins. They actually make vitamins and make minerals absorbable and so on. So they're really contributing to all of the systems in the body that generate energy versus fatigue. And you know, we could do a whole thing on the bacteria in the creating gum disease and the good ones that prevent it. Skin disorders. Anybody that's ever had candida and figured out that's what was causing their skin rash, or that they had skin rash because they ate gluten and they're not celiac, but their body wasn't processing it properly, maybe because it didn't have the bacteria. Things end up on the skin. That's kind of the body's last chance to get rid of poisons. Sinusitis. I'm waiting for it to hear a ENT, a ear, nose, and throat guy say, oh, you have chronic sinus, it's probably not a bacteria, we shouldn't give you an antibiotic, it's probably fungus, therefore it's related to your gut. Let's get your gut under control. Because that's the truth. Now, that's the kind of thing that you will hear here at the Cassandis Institute, but I can guarantee you that is rare and shouldn't be. I don't know if we'll get back to it or not, but with the vaginal yeast infections, there's definitely certain strains of bacteria that you take them orally and they solve vaginal problems. So this idea that we have in medicine now where everybody has a department and they shouldn't stray from their department. You know, if you're a dermatologist, that pretty much means you went through medical school and you learned how to say cortisone. Or you're a kidney doctor, a lung doctor, any of those, that is your territory. No, these things are all connected. They're hooked together, and you can't affect one without affecting the other. And that goes when you're spiraling up, you're getting healthier, you're working on one thing, if you're doing the right things, two or three other things get better. The same thing works when we're sliding down the slippery slope to crisis medicine. Now, I saw a ton of studies in the psychiatric journals. That tickles me a lot, because that's one area where if you went to a doctor with chronic fatigue, even fibromyalgia in the early days, before there was a drug recommendation for it, you were likely to be told it was all in your head and sent to a psychologist or psychiatrist. And they were treating everything, and I'm afraid still are at the practice level, everything is a drug deficiency. You don't have enough Prozac or whatever the antidepressant or anxiety drug du jour is. But it turns out now that so many other things related to the nervous system, including multiple sclerosis, are being linked to disorder in the gut. I mean, multiple sclerosis makes sense. It's an autoimmune disease. I think virtually all autoimmune diseases come from a disrupted gut. And I think you'll find that a pretty prevalent idea in natural, integrative, complementary medicine. It's certainly not a deficiency of the drugs that they give you to calm down the symptoms. But Alzheimer's, boy, there's a fertile ground for, we don't have any effective drugs for Alzheimer's, so they might actually be forced to look at causes like what's going on in the gut. That might come sooner more than some of the other things. So all of this magic that the bacteria create, we got to look at how they do it, because it just otherwise sounds magical. We have, this is another place where I think the media misleads us. They talk about, oh, you have a genetic predisposition for whatever. One of the scariest ones is when they say, oh, you have a family history and you have a genetic variant that might make you more subject to breast cancer. Okay, let's cut them off. Without going back and looking at what some of the other factors are. And what are the subgroups that have that and don't get breast cancer? What are they doing different? That would be a worthy thing to ask. Well, our genes are, they're information, they're suggestions, they're like toggle switch. They can be on or they can be off. And that applies to the ones that do good things for us and the bad things for us. What keeps them in the optimum position? Well, a lot of that has to do with the messages that are being sent by our good bacteria. They are changing the way our genes operate. They also change other microbes. This is a big one. Every degenerative disease comes down to, well, yeah, all of the doctors and the researchers will say, well, yeah, there's inflammation. So their answer is an anti-inflammatory drug, which then will cause bleeding or strokes or, you know, something else. But what if our gut bacteria can help reduce the inflammation? The bacteria get rid of excess hormones. Gee, that might be useful in the case of breast cancer, more prostate cancer. When it reduces cholesterol, the gut doesn't do it by cutting off, which is most of the drugs, if you read the description, in the more technical description, it's anti-something, antibiotic, anticholinergic, anti-acid, and so it's against something. It's stopping the way the body ordinarily would do something. When you do it the natural way with the gut, if something's too low, it helps it come up. If it's something too high, it helps it come down. And it improves the process that would ordinarily keep cholesterol low. That's why I'm such a fan. they're starting now to do all these horribly expensive drugs that improve the immune system for cancer. But our gut bacteria are very sophisticated in not only what they can go after. They go after bad bacteria and viruses directly, but they also send messages to the immune system. There will be, for example, and I'll probably have to just skip over this later, but if a virus hides inside a cell, then the immune system can't see it. It's invisible, so it just, you know, those cells just go right on by. When it's good bacteria there, they know. Somehow they sense it. They have all these internal communications. They tell the immune system, look in there, there's a bad guy. And our immune system can then go after it. So I think you're beginning to see why I am such a fan of these bacteria. Even though it was the biggest pain in the tush to write that book, at the end of it, I went, wow, God is providing the answers and just must be totally amused at our clumsiness and getting around to discovering them. Leaky gut, that could be an entire seminar in itself, but if you want to talk about the autoimmune diseases, you really can't do that without talking about leaky gut. Because basically what happens, and I don't think I have in here a good illustration, but the cells that line the gut are supposed to be very tight together, and they have all of these villi that aid the absorption of nutrients. Each one of these fingers is covered with like a shag rug, so those are the microvilli. So that's a very important system. It keeps bad things out. Well, if the gut gets all deranged, these things stop repairing themselves, so you're not absorbing the nutrients, and gaps open up, those tight junctions stop being tight. So things are getting into the blood that have no business being there. Food that's not all the way digested, and toxins and poisons of various kinds, like from yeast to mycotoxins, can just really wreck your brain function. And so what you want to do is repair that, get it back, get this going. And again, a rheumatologist, it would be a rare one that talks about that, because like we get our education from commercials and packages, they get theirs from drug companies. Mm-hmm. Drug companies don't have a drug for leaky gut, so they aren't going to talk about it.